بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين له النعمة وله الفضل وله الثناء الحسن صلوات الله البر الرحيم والملائكة المقربين على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah Ta'ala to increase our knowledge and benefit us with the knowledge we have acquired. Ameen. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Qur'an, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. This is the first ayah of Surat Al-Isra. And this ayah is in reference to the nighted journey that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took from Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. And this verse explicitly mentioned about this great miracle of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which we will be talking about in detail insha'Allah azza wa jal. Let us first clarify some of the words mentioned in this ayah. Allah Ta'ala said, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا. السبح, from which the word سبحان is derived, السبح means linguistically to be far from. When you are very far from, that's called السبح. But here it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clear from any resemblance to the creations in any way whatsoever. So you know, when you say subhanallah, you say it by your tongue, but many people do not know the meaning of subhanallah. When you say subhanallah, you mean by I clear Allah azza wa jal from any resemblance to the creations in any way whatsoever. That's the meaning of subhanallah. Because when you look at a human being, you see how weak they are, and Allah does not resemble them. When you see the mountains, when you see the rivers, when you see all these magnificent creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you say subhanallah, because the creator, the one who created them, does not resemble them in any way whatsoever. So that's the meaning of subhanallah when you say. So the ayah says, subhanallazi asra bi'abdihi layla. Exalted is he, glorified is he. And that is in reference to Allah, the one who enabled his slave, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to take the nighted journey from Al-Masjid Al-Haram, that is in Mecca, to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. Al-Isra, linguistically, any journey at night, any journey that you take at night is called Al-Isra. Allah Ta'ala said, Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi. Had Allah not mentioned Laylan afterwards, it is clear linguistically that this journey took place at night. But then it was emphasized with the word Laylan. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi Laylan. That's to confirm this great miracle of Al-Isra. And that is this emphasis on it as well entails and proves that this journey was not a dream. Rather, it was a reality. Something real that happened to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam took this night journey with his body and soul while awake, not in a dream, from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. And that also confirms in the word Laylan that it only took one part of the night. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi Laylan. So this journey took place in one part of the night. Al-Masjid Al-Haram, the mosque in Mecca, you know where the Kaaba is. That is called Al-Masjid Al-Haram, with the surrounding building. That is called Al-Masjid Al-Haram. Now, why it is called Al-Masjid Al-Haram? Due to its sanctity, sacredness, and the specific rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam pertaining to this mosque. It's not like any other mosque. Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca, where they circumambulate the Kaaba. What are the merits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala privileged this mosque over other mosques? First, the multiplication of the reward by many, many, many times. It was mentioned in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, As-salatu fil masjid al-haram bimi'ati alfi salah. The reward of the prayer in Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca is multiplied by 100,000 times. Bimi'ati alfi salah, 100,000 times. Do you know what does that mean? If you pray an obligatory prayer or a recommended prayer, optional prayer, in Al-Masjid Al-Haram, in that mosque, the reward will be multiplied by 100,000 times. If you go to any mosque, any ordinary mosque around the world, and you pray in it, you get the rewards multiplied by 50 times. Then if you pray in congregation, you earn the reward of congregational prayer that is multiplied by 27 again. So just imagine when you pray in congregation in the mosque, any ordinary mosque like here, with the good intention in your heart, you receive at least 50 times 27. More than when you pray at home by yourself. So you have the reward of the congregational prayer, and you have the reward of praying in the mosque. Now, apart from the ordinary mosques, we have Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem. The reward in Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem is multiplied by 500 times. So not 50, 500. Because that's Al-Aqsa Mosque. It's special as well. If you pray in the Prophet's Mosque, the reward is multiplied by 1,000, which is multiplied by the 500 in Al-Aqsa Mosque. So the total will be 500,000. That's the multiplication of the reward you get when you pray in the Prophet's Mosque. When you pray in Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca, as the Prophet mentioned, multiplied by 100,000 times, multiplied by the 1,000 in the Prophet's Mosque, multiplied by the 500 in Al-Aqsa Mosque. So you will have 50 billion of multiplication of reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Allah is Ash-Shakur, the one who gives abundance of rewards for an act of worship that you perform that won't take from you that effort or that time. But you will be rewarded greatly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Al-Masjid Al-Haram is called Al-Masjid Al-Haram due to its sanctity, sacredness, because it was specified with many rules. One of them is the multiplication of the reward. But it's not true what some people may falsely claim, that as the rewards are multiplied in Al-Masjid Al-Haram, the sins are multiplied. That's not true. In the hadith, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam talked about the multiplication of the rewards. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the virtue of praying next to Kaaba in Al-Masjid Al-Haram every year, inshaAllah azza wa jal. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was given a strength of 40 men. The most courageous. The reason why he immigrated to Medina is because he was instructed through the revelation to take the believers and move to Medina so they can establish the foundations of this Muslim nation. Then after 8 years, he came back to Mecca and he conquered Mecca. So there was a benefit in the immigration. Many lessons are learned from the immigration of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So when he was leaving Mecca, he looked at it and he farewelled it with a glance and a word. He said to Mecca, Allah knows that you are the best of all locations on earth. And you are the best place honored by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And had I not been in a situation where I have to leave you, I wouldn't have left you. The Prophet loved Mecca. Then he went to Medina and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him the barakah, the blessings in Medina twice as it was in Mecca. After the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam immigrated to Medina, he supplicated Allah and he said, "Oh Allah, bless the people of Medina twice as you bless the people of Mecca." And subhanallah, Al-Madina became very blessed. Before that, people used to get sick in Medina and diseases would occur to them. They might be inflicted with diseases. That how it was before when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam immigrated to Medina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleared from all these diseases. And it became blessed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed also the trees and the plants of Al-Madina. So that's another reason. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade one to hunt the wild edible animals while in Mecca. So you cannot like hunt birds, deer, and the like while you are in Mecca. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام. We know now why it is called Al-Haram, due to its sanctity, sacredness. إلى المسجد الأقصى. The Prophet took that journey from Al-Masjid Al-Haram to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Why it is called Al-Aqsa, the far, the one that is very far from Al-Masjid Al-Haram. So it was very far from Mecca. So it was called Al-Aqsa. Al-Aqsa means the far from Al-Masjid Al-Haram. Both of them were built by Prophet Adam alayhi salam. Some scholars did mention that Al-Kaaba was built first by the angels. Some scholars did mention that Al-Kaaba first was built by the angels. Many scholars said Adam built Al-Kaaba. Then after 40 years, he built Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called Al-Masjid, you know what masjid means, mosque. Is it built by this nation? No. Al-Masjid Al-Haram was built by Adam. Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa by Adam after 40 years. So from the time of Adam, it was built. And it was called Al-Masjid. See how now we say, we recite the ayah, سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. So it is a mosque, masjid. Although it was built before this nation, this is because it was built like any other mosque in order for the believers, the Muslims, to pray in them and to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these mosques. Because all the prophets came with one religion, which is Al-Islam. All the prophets came with one religion. The message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. The message of Tawheed. The message about the essentials of the creed is one. So all the prophets called the people to believe in Allah and not to associate partners with Him. They told them about believing in prophets, believing in angels, believing in the day of judgment, about all these matters. So in the creedal matters, all the prophets came with the same essentials of the belief. But they differed in matters of practice based on the best interest of the people at that time. For instance, during the time of Adam alayhi salam, Allah revealed to Prophet Adam that one can marry his sister, but not the twin sister, the sister from another pregnancy. Why? Because Eve, Hawa, became pregnant 40 times and she delivered about 80 children. In each pregnancy, she used to have a male and a female. And to be more specific, as some scholars said, the last pregnancy she carried only one baby boy, and that turned to be Prophet Sheikh alayhi salam. So you can say 40 girls, like females, and 39 males, all of them brothers and sisters. If that was not allowed for one to marry his sister, human beings would have become extinct by now. So they won't have any more human beings. So for them to reproduce and increase, Allah revealed to Prophet Adam the permissibility of one marrying his sister but from different pregnancy. That's why they had that cross marriage. So the male from this pregnancy to the female of that pregnancy. And the female in this pregnancy to the male of that pregnancy. By this way they reproduced. By the time Adam alayhi salam passed away, he was able to see from his offspring, meaning his children and the children of his children, 40,000. So when Adam alayhi salam died, Allah revealed to Prophet Sheikh, his son, that it's no longer permissible for one to marry his sister because they became numerous, thousands. So now cousins can marry. And that's why the number increased. So Allah called this Masjid Al-Kaaba, Masjid, Masjid Al-Haram, Masjid, where the Kaaba is, and Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, Masjid, although they were not built by the Muslims of this nation, because all the followers of all the prophets in the past, the true followers of all the prophets were Muslims. And they used to worship Allah in these places that we call them mosques. Then Allah said, أَلَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ. So the Prophet took that night journey from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ, which is surrounded by a blessed area. It is in a blessed region and surrounded by blessed regions as well. Because Al-Aqsa Mosque is located in the land of Asham. The land of Asham, now Palestine, Jordan, Lebanon, and Syria are all within the boundaries of what we call Bilad al-Sham, the lands of Asham. So Al-Aqsa is in that region. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as narrated by Al-Bukhari in his Sahih, made a special supplication for the people of Asham by saying, O Allah, I ask you to bless our Sham, the land of Asham, and the land of Yemen. You know where Yemen is? Next to Saudi Arabia now. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, O Allah, bless the land of Sham and the land of Yemen. Then some who were from Najd. Najd is Al-Riyadh and its surrounding. They said, what about our Najd? Then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Allahumma barik fi shamina wa yamanina. He didn't mention Najd. They said, what about Najd? He said, Allahumma barik fi shamina wa yamanina. They said, what about Najd? And he said, from there, the tribulations and the earthquakes would take place, and from there, the horn of the devil will emerge from that region. So he supplicated Allah to bless the region of Asham and the region of Yemen. When they asked him about Najd, he said, from there the tribulations and the earthquakes will take place. And from there as well, the horn of the devil will emerge. Who emerged from these areas? Musaylimah al-Kazzab. Musaylimah, who claimed prophethood at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Then other imposters, they all emerged from that region. So the land of Asham, including Palestine, where Al-Aqsa Mosque is located, is a blessed land. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. So I'm just saying it word by word. سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا. Exalted is Allah. Glorified is Allah. Clear is Allah from any resemblance to the creations. The one who enabled his slave, and that is Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, to take the nighted journey from Al-Masjid Al-Haram, that is in Mecca, to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem, which is located in a blessed region and surrounded by blessed regions as well. لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. To allow the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to see some of the wondrous creations of Allah Azza wa Jal. لِنُرِيَهُ. So this lamb in Arabic, it's like in English you say, in order to. So it clarifies the reason. You might say, I went to Lebanon in order to further my study in Arabic. In order to, that's the reason. So why did you travel to Lebanon? In order to increase your knowledge in Arabic. So that's in order to, that's alam, the reason. لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. So Allah enabled the Prophet to take that nighty journey from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. Why? Why? What's the reason? لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. The Prophet can see the wondrous creations of Allah Azza wa Jal. So that was the reason. Also about the ascension of the Prophet, which is a continuation of that journey to the seven skies and what is beyond, Allah Ta'ala in Surah Al-Najm mentioned, لَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى. Indeed, he saw the magnificent and great signs and the wondrous creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that shows that in both the trips, both the journeys, the landed journey and the journey, the ascension to the skies, was to enable the Prophet to see the wondrous creations of Allah, and that is of course to raise his rank, because this did not happen to any of the Prophets before him. So to raise the rank of the Prophet, to enable him to see the wondrous creations of Allah, which we'll be talking about inshallah tonight and next week inshallah Azza wa Jal, about these wondrous creations that he saw during this journey. This is to raise the rank of the Prophet by giving him something that wasn't given to any Prophet before him. So that was the reason for this journey. to enable the Prophet to see the wondrous creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second, to raise the rank of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Because as you may know, that the Prophet led them in the prayer in Al-Aqsa Mosque. All the Prophets were gathered for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam for his honor. And Jibreel asked him to lead them in the prayer. And that shows that he is the best of all the Prophets. Then in every sky he met some of the Prophets as well. So after he prayed with them in congregation, they went up to the skies, not all of them, some of them. And as the Prophet was ascending from one sky to another, he used to see some Prophets at the gate of each paradise welcoming the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. What a great honor. What a great honor. And they used to say to him, Marhaban, marhaban bika ya Muhammad. Welcome, welcome, O Muhammad. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam took this journey. It's a great miracle for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and that is to show his status, the status that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to our beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The journey was not meant, as some misguided people claim, walayyazu billah, they think that the purpose of this journey was for the Prophet to go up, to reach a place where he can sit with God, walayyazu billah, as we sit with each other. That's not the belief of Muslims. This is the belief of what they call them anthropomorphists. Those who claim that Allah has bodily attributes. Those who claim that Allah is a body with limbs and organs. They believe that Allah is like a human being. That's not the belief of the believers. The believers believe that Allah does not resemble any of the creations whatsoever. Allah said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing resembles Allah in any way whatsoever. And the one who thinks and believes that Allah is a body with limbs, he's not a believer, because he's not worshipping God. He's worshipping an image that he imagined. So he's not worshipping God. He's worshipping something that does not even exist in real life. Only in his imagination, only in his mind, he has that image that he imagined, and he's worshipping that image. So those who believe that Allah is a body, big body with limbs, and that Allah is sitting on the throne, in fact, there's no such a thing. In reality, there's no such a thing that is big body that looks like a human being that is sitting on the throne. There's no such a thing. So the one who worships this imagination is not worshipping Allah. He is worshipping this image that he has imagined. This image that was created by Allah in his mind. Because when one imagines something, you know, that image comes to his mind. Yeah, it wasn't before it came into existence. Who created that image? Allah. So he would be worshipping an image that is created by Allah. He won't be worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why he's not a believer. But as for the verses of the Quran, such as Ar-Rahmanu 'ala al-'arshi istawa, it doesn't mean Allah sat on the throne. It means Allah subjugated the arsh by his power. Subdued the arsh by his power. Controlled the arsh by his power. Preserved the arsh from perishing. The arsh does not perish. Because it's the ceiling of paradise. That's why the Prophet said, if you were to ask Allah a place in paradise, ask of Allah al-Firdaus. Because it's in the middle of paradise. at the highest level of paradise, the ceiling of which is the grand throne of Allah Azza wa Jal. Al-Arsh. Allah created the Arsh as an indication of His power. And the Arsh is like Kaaba for us. When we go to Mecca to make tawaf, don't we circumambulate the Kaaba? Of course we do. Does that mean because we believe that Allah is inside the Kaaba? No. Because Allah ordered us to glorify this house, Al-Kaaba. So when we are turning around the Kaaba, it's like we are saying, oh Allah, as you ordered us to worship you, wherever we go, wherever we turn, we remain steadfast on worshiping you. That's the meaning of At-Tawaf. That's the wisdom behind At-Tawaf. What about the angels who are in the skies? Allah created for them Al-Arsh. Al-Arsh for them is like a Kaaba. And angels turn around Al-Arsh. And that is mentioned in the Quran, in Surat Az-Zumar, the last ayah. وترى الملائكة حافين من حول العرش يسبحون بحمد ربهم وقضي بينهم بالحق وقيل الحمد لله رب العالمين وترى الملائكة حافين من حول العرش turning around the arsh, circumambulating the arsh. What do they do? يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ. They praise Allah. As when we go to Mecca, we turn around Kaaba, we also make tasbih. We praise Allah Azza wa Jal. So the arsh for the angels is like the Kaaba for us here on earth. So Allah did not create the arsh to sit on it, because sitting is an attribute of the creation, the human seat. If you look now at each one of you, everyone is sitting, but the way he is sitting is different. Every one of you is sitting, and the way he is sitting is different from the other one. Sitting is our attribute as humans, as bodies. Animals sit, insects sit, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not resemble the creations. Sitting is amongst the attributes of the creations, and we must clear Allah from any resemblance to the creations. That's why the scholars like Zunnun al-Masri and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, may Allah raise the rank, said, مَهْمَا تَصَوَّرْتَ بِبَالِكَ فَاللَّهُ بِخِلَافِ ذَلِكَ. Meaning, whatever you imagine in your mind, Allah does not resemble it. Because whatever you imagine is a creation. You imagine what? What can you imagine? You can imagine a body, you can imagine a color, you can imagine a quantity, a mass, a volume, dimensions. That's what you can imagine. Allah is not like that. Because this imagination is imprinted image in your mind that Allah created. So that is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Plus Allah is the creator of the arsh. Allah is the creator of the kursi. Allah is the creator of the skies. Allah is the creator of paradise and hell. Allah is the creator of earth. Allah is the creator of this whole universe. So before creating the arsh, before creating al-kursi, before creating the skies and earth, before creating places and directions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was existent without being in them. Because Allah does not dwell places. After creating them, Allah does not change. So as Allah was without a place before creating the places, Allah is still without a place after creating the places. Is that clear? This is very simple for one to understand the proof. So if one falsely claims that Allah is sitting on the throne, you say to him, who created the arsh? He will say, Allah. So if you are claiming that Allah now is sitting on the arsh, what about before creating the arsh? That means you are claiming that Allah has changed. And the change is the most obvious sign that such a thing is a creation. How do you know you are a creation? Because you are changing every day. And you know you are not changing yourself. Every day, from the day you were born, every day you see a change in your life. Till you become old, you have gray hair and the like. You see all these changes. And you know you are not changing yourself. So you are a creation of the one who is changing you. You are a creation of the one who is changing you. That's why change is the most obvious sign that such a thing is a creation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists without a place before and after creating the places. Allah doesn't need the place. Who created the place? Allah. Allah doesn't need it. Who created the arsh? Allah doesn't need it. Who created al-kursi? Allah doesn't need it. Who created the skies? Allah doesn't need it. Allah doesn't need any of the creations. Doesn't need the skies. The skies were created for the angels. It's the inhabitant of angels. The Prophet mentioned in the hadith that there is no distance, meaning empty space, in the skies, which is equivalent to four fingers, or a span in another narration, without there being an angel worshipping Allah, praying and standing, or you see him in the bowing position or in the prostration, sujood position. See how you get to the mosque and you see like everyone is praying, one is standing, one is in ruku, one is in sujood, then one goes up, then one goes down. You see that in the mosque? The skies are filled and crowded with angels to the extent that the Prophet said that at every distance of four fingers, in another narration, one span, there is an angel who is praying and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why it's impossible for Allah to be in the skies with the angels crowded. That's impossible. Plus these skies will be destroyed on the day of judgment. Allah said, وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ كُشِطَتْ. They will fall. And Allah said, يَوْمَ نَطْوِي السَّمَاءَ كَطَيِّ السِّجِلِّ لِلْكُتُبِ. That's in Surah Al-Anbiya. The skies will be folded, as books are folded on top of each other. So, would a sound-minded person believe that Allah is in the sky and the skies will collapse on him on the day of judgment? A'udhu billah. So why did Allah create the skies? As an inhabitant for the angels. Why did Allah create earth? It's the inhabitant for humans, jinn and animals. But Allah does not need the places because Allah does not need the creations, and places are part of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the prophets as mercy. Sent the prophets as mercy to the slaves. Because by one using his sound intellect, I'm saying sound intellect, not the one who is insane, the one who has sound intellect, he wouldn't be able to know all the matters that will save him in the hereafter. Just imagine no one told you about praying five times a day. How would you know? Even if you are very smart, even if your IQ, what's the highest IQ they say? You don't know. See that measure they have, even if it is 10, Yeah, you won't be able to know that you need to pray five times a day, and that subh is two rak'ahs, zuhur is four, asr is four, maghrib is three, isha is four, and the time of each prayer is between this time and that time. How would you know this? You can't know. How do you know that you need to fast? You don't know. So the prophets were sent as a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the slaves, because one wouldn't be able independently by using his sound mind to know the matters that will save him in the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala graced us with this great endowment by sending the prophets to us. And Allah supported them with miracles to show the truthfulness that they are sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because al-mu'jiza, miracle, happens only to the prophets. It is an extraordinary occurrence that happens to the prophets. It supports their claim and cannot be imitated. Cannot be imitated. No one can defeat the mu'jiza. When the Pharaoh of Egypt brought the sorcerers, according to one narration there were 70, according to another narration there were 1,000. Those sorcerers that he gathered them to challenge Prophet Musa alayhi salam, they threw their staffs and robes, and they affected by their sorcery the eyes of the people. Musa alayhi salam threw his staff. It turned into a huge real serpent, big snake, and it ate everything they threw to the ground. When the sorcerers saw this, they knew this can't be sorcery. They knew this is something, a support to this man from Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's why they prostrated and they said, "We believe in the Lord of Musa and Harun." They testified that no one is God but God, and that Musa and Harun are prophets of God. So they believed. Why did they believe? Because they knew this is not a kind of sorcery. This is a miracle that Allah supported Prophet Musa with. That's why, because it cannot be imitated, it cannot be imitated, they accepted Islam and they embraced Islam. And out of all the prophets, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the most and best miracles. It was said that Imam Al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu said, "Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to any of the prophets before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the miracles, Allah gave Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam a similar one or a greater one." And the miracles of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam were greater than these miracles given to the previous prophets. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was given miracles greater than the miracles of the previous prophets. Then the one who was asking Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, and his name is Umar ibn Sawad, he said to Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, "Isa alayhi salam was given the miracle of reviving the dead." Because Isa alayhi salam used to supplicate Allah, and by the power of Allah, that dead would be revived, brought back to life. So imagine someone who is dead, Isa alayhi salam supplicates Allah, and that dead is brought back to life. So that's something like a great miracle. Then Al-Shafi'i said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was given a greater one. He was given the mourning of the dead trunk of the palm tree, and that is greater, until its voice was heard by all those in the mosque. This is a greater, you know why? Because usually a human being, how is he alive with body and soul? What's the definition of death? When the soul departs the body, that's called death. So when the soul comes out of the body, he turns what? Dead. So he was alive already, a human being alive, talking and walking, alive. So when the soul departed the body, he became dead. When Isa alayhi salam supplicated Allah, Allah brought back that soul into this dead person, he was brought back to life. But originally he was alive. What about the dead trunk of a palm tree? It's a tree, doesn't have a soul, doesn't have emotions, doesn't have feelings, doesn't have any of that, just a tree. And it's dead. That's another thing. What do we mean by dead here? So it was chopped off and it doesn't grow anymore. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to lean on it when delivering the speech. Then they suggested, O Messenger of Allah, what about if we make a pulpit for you, minbar? He said, do it if you want. So he did a minbar for the Prophet, so he can stand on it and give the sermon on Friday, the speech on Friday. So on Friday, that's the next Friday, he went up to the minbar and he started the khutbah. As he started the khutbah, everyone in the mosque started hearing the weeping and crying like a little baby crying and weeping. When they chased the source, it was that dead trunk of the palm tree. The dead trunk of the palm tree cried as a baby cries. The Prophet went down, gave it a hug until it settled and calmed down. This is greater than the miracle given to Prophet Isa alayhi salam, the miracle of reviving the dead. Because he was already alive, he died and he was brought back to life. But that dead trunk of a palm tree, to be alive, to have emotions and feelings, to cry and weep, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam stopped leaning on her, that is greater. That is greater. And amongst the greatest miracles of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, which we'll be talking in detail inshaAllah azza wa jal next week. Barakallahu feekum, and Allah knows best.